Hey guys, and welcome back to Music 154, Form Analysis with Professor Bearson. So, you guys will probably remember that I used to play in a death metal band called Hell of Blood. Well, that experience has left me with a certain kind of an expertise. And what I'd like to do today is talk with you about progressive form in rock music. So I'm going to start off today's class with a claim. You may agree with it or disagree with it, but that claim is, and this is what our whole semester has been leading to, progressive form in rock music is analogous to sonata form in classical music. So all the stuff that we studied until the midterm, the first half of the semester, we talked about how sonata form is an expansion of binary and ternary forms based on dramatic techniques borrowed from opera. Well, I'm saying now that progressive form in rock is essentially an expansion of verse-chorus form based on, so opera is not a big deal anymore. It used to be in the classical period, but now it's not anymore. So there's other things that get borrowed or used as concepts to expand on the form. So as an example, we're going to study Tool's Lateralus, which expands verse-chorus form based on a mathematical concept known as the Fibonacci series. So as I just mentioned, progressive form is kind of like how sonata form grows out of the binary and the ternary forms. Remember that it borrowed the techniques from opera to do so, and that gave it a dramatic purpose to grow the form. In rock music, we have progressive form, and that grows out of verse-chorus form. So now that we're in a different time period, there's other things that influence the growth of verse-chorus form into a more profound a vehicle for musical expression. So concepts like math or spirituality or literature can now come into play and help us expand the concept based off of verse-chorus form. Here's a reminder of what verse-chorus form looks like. So we've got AABA. Each A section has in and of itself a progression of events. Okay, we talked about it before, it's dynamic. It's a sort of crescendo from the verse to the chorus. So the band we're going to be covering today is Tool. They formed in Los Angeles in 1990. They are kind of like grunge, hard rock, but also known as progressive metal because of their complex later songs. They're a four-piece group. Drums, Danny Carey. Bass, Justin Chancellor. Guitar, Adam Jones. And vocals, Maynard Keenan. One of the reasons they're known as progressive metal is because of this album Lateralus that came out in 2002. The song is Lateralus from this album. We'll be studying that today. It's based on the Fibonacci series and then uses of polymeter and polyrhythm. So the Fibonacci series is a set of numbers that you get each next number by adding the previous two numbers. So it starts from 0 and then 1. 0 plus 1 is 1, 1 plus 1 is 2, 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5, 3 plus 5 is 8, etc., etc. This series can go on forever. If you were to take the numbers of the Fibonacci series and put them in a grid, then you would get a spiral. It gets kind of spiritual because people can see this Fibonacci series, the shape of the spiral, in nature. So you can see the shape of a snail's shell, for example, based on the Fibonacci series, a spiral. Also galaxies. Those are spirals that are based on the Fibonacci series. So you can imagine the sort of connection this has with spirituality and math. So the idea that nature or life in general is based on mathematical or divine mathematical concepts. The way the Fibonacci series works in Lateralis is in the first verse, where the first eight numbers of the Fibonacci series, sorry, the first six numbers of the Fibonacci series are in the syllables of the verses. So Maynard Keenan will sing one syllable, then two syllables, then three, then five, then eight. Then he goes back down, and then in the second little stanza there of the verse, you go to 13, which is the next number in the Fibonacci series, 8 plus 5, and you come back down in the number of syllables.
Now, normally, before we start doing the analysis of the form, we listen to the whole song. This song is 9 minutes and 25 seconds long, so it would be a really long video. I mean, it's possible to do, but what I would rather do is go straight into the analysis, and I'll play each segment as we analyze it. But before we do that, I invite you to go ahead and find the song on YouTube and listen to the whole thing first, so that you get a first impression of the song without any analysis, okay? Just enjoy the song, and then that enjoyment of the song will then inform your analysis later on.
Okay, let's get into the analysis. The song is a great example of how to build complex musical forms by adding layers after every period. So remember, a period is 8 bars, 2 phrases of 4 bars each, and each of those phrases, furthermore, has 2 measure ideas within it. A lot of these riffs or melodies or musical ideas, they're always going to fit within 2 bars. So every time something new happens, it's going to happen every 8 bars. This is a great example of what's going on in the introduction here. So here we are with the intro, and I've got this bluesy riff that happens, motive X, just like solo clean guitar, and it's kind of just mysterious in terms of what's going on. So that's your first 2-measure idea, and that happens again in the next 2-measure idea, forming the first phrase. In the second phrase, we still have that same riff going on, and then in the last 2-measure idea, we get this really faint rhythmic pulse in the background, which I'm calling motive Y. So that makes up the second phrase, and that's our first period. And these 2 motives, X and Y, the rhythmic pulse and then the bluesy riff, are going to form the basis for the entire song. Now what's happening in the second period, new notes have been added to the bluesy riff. We get these 2 long notes for the first 2 measures, and then the bluesy riff continues in the next 2 measures, all while the rhythmic pulse Y continues. So this is what's happening now in the second period. Let's listen to that.
Guys, a quick note on the main riff to this song, okay? Just double checked it. Okay, you can see me. So it's on guitar, obviously, not piano, but drop D tuning for the guitar. So we're in the key of D minor-ish. But I want to show you how, remember last class I told you how the blues has influenced all this music. Well, Tool is basically a blues band, okay? Because what this first riff tells us, watch, when you break it down. Song is based off of these notes, right? So if I were to just reduce this, it would be a 5-note pentatonic blues scale on D minor.
All right, now in this third period, we're still going with the same stuff, but the pulse has gotten louder. So 4 bars and 4 more bars, all the same stuff. This next period, just the pulse is louder and all the same stuff is going on. Let's listen. Now we get to the last period of the intro, and what's changed here is that the Y motive, the pulse, is heard more clearly as the bass and the drums. You hear clear snare drum and the bass guitar being picked away in the background, and that's going on for the next period. And then there's 2 more measures tacked onto the end of it, and that makes a total of 34 bars for the intro. And I just put that 34, just FYI, is a Fibonacci number. But I don't think that really was intentional. Anyway, let's listen to that. So this intro is really going to form the basis of the entire song. It's got your X and your Y motives, but also just remember, I mean, every 8 bars, something new is introduced. Okay, there's a layer built on top of the previous layers. And this is also part of what's going on with progressive form. So now we push into the next part of the intro, but it's the chorus riff. And the chorus riff clearly builds off of the rhythmic pulse in motive Y. So I'm going to call it Y prime, which I have in parentheses there. But it's unique because it's made up of 3 measures. I'm calling it a 3-measure idea now, not a 2-measure idea. And each of the measures is 1 beat less in the meter than the previous measure. So it goes from 9/8 to 8/8 to 7/8. And this happens for 3 cycles, forming a phrase. Okay, so this is an irregular phrase. It's not 2 bars. It's not two-measure ideas making 4 bars, but rather it's 3 3-measure ideas making 9 bars. So it is kind of like mathematically proportional if you think about it. Remember from our ear training class last semester that we talked about odd meters and counting them. The beat structure for the 9/8 is going to be 3 plus 3 plus 3. And then for the 8/8, it's going to be an odd meter in this case, is 3 plus 3 plus 2. And then for the 7/8, we're going to do 2 plus 2 plus 3. So let me show you what I mean. 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Okay, and then the 9/8 and 7 of the meters, if you put them together, it actually forms a Fibonacci number, which is 987, and you can see it right there. Again, that's probably a coincidence. It wasn't intentional, but nevertheless, it's there and happens to be a Fibonacci number. Okay, let's listen. All right, now we're going to get to the first A section with verse 1. And we are now in 5/8 meter. So because we're in 5/8 meter, the rhythmic pulse is going on in the drums, and I'm going to call that a Y double prime. It's a variant of the Y motive, but in 5/8 meter. And the drums are only happening right now while the Fibonacci series is happening in the vocals. And that's what's going to go on for this whole first period. Let's listen. Black than white are all I see in my infancy. Red and yellow then came to be. Reaching out to me, let's me see. Now when the second period begins, again something new has come in, and this is now the bass. The bass is entering on X double prime. It's a motive that I'm saying is based on X. It's not so clear, but I think that it's kind of this bluesy riff, and it's got these 2 long notes, and I think it's connected somehow to the motive X from the beginning. So I'm going to call that X double prime. And this is what's going on here. Let's listen to that. All right, now in the third period, the guitar is going to enter, strumming along the rhythmic pulse with the drums as Y double prime. And that happens for the whole period now, okay? And also try to count along while this is going on. As below, so above and beyond, I imagine, drawn beyond the lines of reason, push the envelope, watch it bend. All right, once we get out of that, we go into the pre-chorus. And this is going to happen for 8 more bars. This time, X double prime and Y double prime combine to form 1 riff. and the vocals have cut out. So that goes on for a whole period of 8 bars, and then after that, there's 2 more bars of 3/8 before we get into the chorus. Let's listen. All right, now we're still in the first A section, and we've gone to our chorus. So we've had this progression of events leading us here, everything happening every 8 bars, more or less. The same meters switching, 9/8, 8/8 to 7/8 with motive Y prime is the riff that's going on in the chorus. Okay, so that happens again, just like it had before in the intro, 3 times, making a phrase. I want to share the lyrics with you here because it's important to remember what exactly is going on in this chorus so you can see how it's expanded in the next chorus. Each line of the chorus listed here coincides with one of the 3-measure ideas. So there's 3 3-measure ideas, and then there's 3 lines of music, 3 lines of lyrics in the vocals. So overthinking, overanalyzing separates the body from the mind. Withering my intuition, missing opportunities, and I must. That's your middle 3-measure idea. And then the last one, feed my will to feel my moment, drawing way outside the lines. So this is going to now be expanded in chorus number 2, but just remember that this is how chorus 1 is put together. All right, let's listen. All right, so just remember again that that's 3 3-measure ideas in the chorus, and it goes with those particular lyrics. All right, let's push ahead. Here we are in the second A section and verse number 2. So we're back to the 5/8 meter, and this is pretty much the same as what happened in the first verse. Now when we get to the second period, the bass comes in again, but this time its X double prime motive has slides in it. So this is different from what happened before. This is a variation on when the bass entered with motive X double prime in verse 1. Okay, now it's got more slides. Listen to that when I play it, but that's what's going on in this period. Okay, let's listen. There is so much more. All right, now we get to the third period, and the guitar enters with Y double prime. So let's listen to that part. As below, so above and beyond, I imagine, drawn outside the lines of reason. Push the envelope, watch it bend. All right, and now we get to the pre-chorus. Same thing, X double prime and Y double prime combine. The vocals cut out, and then we get 2 extra bars of 3/8. Let's listen. So just like in verse 1, verse 2, has something new enter every 8 bars. So each period is a new unit with an extra level of complexity added. And the Fibonacci series has occurred in the verses only. Okay, let's move ahead to chorus number 2. So we're still in A2, and our chorus has begun. And the 9/8, 8/8, 7/8 of motive Y prime is happening, but this time it happens for only two 3-measure ideas, before the third line of the lyrics can come in, a guitar solo enters for three measure ideas for 9 bars total. Okay, so we get another phrase right there. It says inserted. And then what happens after that, the first line, the vocals come back with the original final lyric of the original chorus, so line 3 of the lyric. And then there's an extra lyric added for one more 3-measure idea, forming another phrase. So we get this whole big thing happening now. It's an expanded chorus with 3 3-measure idea guitar solo sections inserted, and then one extra 3-measure idea added as an extra lyric is added to the mix. So here's now the vocals. Overthinking, overanalyzing separates the body from the mind. That's first part. Withering my intuition, leaving opportunities behind. That's the second one. Then there's a guitar solo. Then the final lyric, feed my will to feel this moment, urging me to cross the line. And then the last 3-measure idea has reaching out to embrace the random, reaching out to embrace whatever may come. All right, let's listen. So chorus number 2 is a perfect example of what I call progressive form, based on verse chorus form. So here we've had our chorus, and in the previous chorus it was 3 3-measure ideas long, right? So basically 9 measures long with all those, you know, one beat shorter meters. Well, now instead of having the verse be just like that, which would be a normal verse chorus form in any popular music song, Tool inserts a guitar solo before the third line of that chorus, right? And then the third line of the chorus itself becomes expanded by one more line. So what was a 3 3-measure section, a 3-measure idea section, now becomes, let's see, 7 3-measure idea sections long, if that makes any sense. Basically, a shorter formal unit was now expanded, okay? And that's progressive form. You take a basic formal idea or formal unit and expand it on other concepts.
Now we normally get to what we call the B section or the bridge. And it begins, it's in 12/8 meter, and it begins with motive Y in the bass. So the rhythm pulse is happening, and it's just like it was when it was first presented at the beginning of the song. So it's not a variant, it is motive Y. This happens for the first phrase. And then in the second phrase of the opening period here, the drums are going to enter with a hi-hat rhythm. And that makes up our first period. Let's listen. Now, when the next period happens, we get the X triple prime motive in the guitar. So this is very similar to what happened at the very beginning of the song, but it's just another variation on the same motive. Okay, so that happens now for the next period. Now when we get the next period, this is when the vocals enter. So again, we're having this layering concept. Every 8 bars, something new happens. Embrace my desire. In this next period, the drums now start to perform a polymeter. So we've got a 5-8 now occurring against the 12-8 that's been going on in the rest of the band this whole time. Continuing with the B section, the polymeter is still going on for another period. Okay, now in this next period, the vocals take on motive X triple prime, we should say. Okay, he starts to sing the same line as the guitar. And the polymeter is going to end in the second phrase. Swing on the spiral. So now we're going to continue on here. Same stuff is happening, X triple prime and Y. All right, so our B section is concluded and it's our bridge. So I guess we're wondering what's going to happen next. Are we going to go into a return to the A section somehow? And we've had quite a bit of complexity increasing as this B section has gone on, I think highlighted by the polymeter and the drums. Let's go ahead and see what happens next.
So what we get actually is not a return to the A section, but a new module of bridge-like material. This is the C section, and in it we get a guitar solo and a drum solo. So, oh, it's kind of like dueling solos, if you will. So we got the guitar solo comes in with the first two measure idea, and it's kind of like this long held notes with the lots of distortion, wah pedal, and some bluesy licks. And then there's a drum fill in the second two measure idea of the first phrase. So the drum fill is just kind of like a precursor of what's about to happen, because this guy Danny Carey is one of the top drum masters of all rock music. Second phrase of the opening period, you get the guitar solo still going on. Second two measure idea of the second phrase is another drum fill. So that's how the first period is structured. Let's give that a listen. All right, now we get into the second period. Guitar solo moves into another phase on different notes, but pretty much the same vibe, long-held notes with bluesy licks. The second two-measure idea is another drum fill by Danny Carey, so we get a four-measure phrase. Then in the second four-measure phrase of the second period, the guitar solo is going, the drum fill comes in the second measure of that and just goes absolutely insane. So this four-measure period has ridiculous drum fills. Okay, I want you to really listen to that. Sounds like the drummer is an octopus, or that's what they say. When the drummer does crazy drum fills, they call it an octopus. And then we get into the, that's the second period. And then there's the motive X prime, those two long-held notes that was associated with the first main motive from the beginning of the song. Those come back with the full band, and that gets us ready for the next section of the song. So let's give that a listen.
All right, now where are we going to go with that? Well, we go to a D section, and it just goes to an outro. I think this outro is significant, by the way, because of the concept of the Fibonacci series and the spiral. This may be a coincidence, but I kind of think that Tool didn't want to come back to the beginning of the A section because the spiral is an open-ended shape. It has no return to the beginning at all, right? So I think that what's going on is they're spiraling out of the form of a verse chorus. What we get here is Y in the guitar, so the rhythmic pulse, okay? And the guitar is doing it for two bars. And then all of a sudden, so just only a two-bar phrase, out of nowhere, we jump in with a 2+3 polyrhythm. The bass and the drums have the 2+3. And that goes on for those four bars in 6/8. Then the vocals come in, and when they do, they come in with a 4/3 polyrhythm against the drums, while the 2+3 is still going on with the bass. The other thing that happens is that the bass starts to play, you know, the bluesy riff. So I'm calling it motive X quadruple prime, because this is a new manifestation of motive X. That happens for the first phrase. The second phrase, X quadruple prime, doesn't happen anymore. It's those two beats. It's not really motive X anymore. So that calms down, and then we have this sort of X and Y, but the polyrhythms are still going on. Let's listen to that.
Okay, so I'm at the polyrhythm section, and I want to go over the two simultaneous polyrhythms that are going on here. First thing we have is the 2/3. What you'll hear, the 2 part is the bass, and the 3 is going to be the cymbals on the drums. Bom, 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 bom. So it's going 1, 2, and 3. Bom, 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 bom. Nice cup of tea. Nice cup of tea. Bom, bom. So we covered that last semester in ear training class. Let me do that again. Good. Okay, so now the vocals are going to come in, and the singer is going to be going 4/3 of the cymbals while the bass is doing 2. So I'm just going to focus right now on the vocal part against the cymbals. So my right hand is doing the vocals, my left is doing the cymbals. Pass the gosh darn butter, pass the gosh darn butter. Okay, so there you have the polyrhythmic sections of this D formal unit.
Next section, we get the same thing, X quadruple prime with the polyrhythms going on. And then in the final phrase of that period, we don't have X quadruple prime anymore. Then we get to the next part where the guitar takes on motive X double prime. And then for the next phrase of the period, it doesn't, right? This, the two pulse is still going on, but it's not quite X. It's not X related to me anymore. All right, after that period, We continue on D, still the outro, but this time the vocals change to spiral out, and that happens for this next 8-bar period. Then the guitar solo takes on motive X, and this is like the X from the beginning. So this is going on for this period. In the end of the second phrase, the band drops out while the guitar continues to play motive X. Let's listen. Alright, now the band only plays on the downbeats for this next 4-bar phrase, and then there's these ending chords, and then we're holding the final note. I'm not sure if we're going to count those measures anymore by that point. It seems like there's a slowdown and then just kind of like a holding off at the end, so I'm not sure if it makes sense to count measures, but anyway, that's how the song ends.
Okay, now that we've analyzed the whole song, let's go back and listen to it without analyzing, just go through and hear it with a more informed ear. Okay, that's this week's class on progressive form in rock music. I hope you learned a lot from this. I certainly did. One of which being that the 8-measure period, 4-measure phrase, 2-measure idea paradigm still works even in the most complex forms of rock or popular music. I also learned that Tool is essentially a blues band, and I am more convinced that just one or two motives is all you need to make a masterpiece level song in any idiom. So we saw just an X and a Y motive varied several times each, but combined contrapuntally in different ways throughout the whole song, right? So, you know, that's all you really need to make a great song. Just two ideas, mix them together, do some variations of them, but that's really it. And every new thing should enter in a logical time in the form, right? So at the beginning of a period or halfway through the period, that's really how music is put together. All right, guys, take care.